Hi, on this episode of the RM Cascadian Growing Together, it's going to be kind of a quiet episode after some of the mystery and intrigue of the last couple of episodes. It's winter here in San Myshuno. It's Christmas, in fact, here in San Myshuno. Reg is expecting his parents to come and visit for this holiday. Reg and Patrick are expecting Reg's parents to come and visit for this Christmas holiday. And so they're going to decorate the tree, of course. Now, a lot of people have seen this. This is how you decorate the tree. You basically just throw things at it and you're good to go. Max is watching all of the festivities, of course. He's getting close to a year old. His birthday is in February. Of course, this is the end of December. So he's getting close to a year old. And they go through the usual tree trimming sort of ceremony here. And it looks good, right? It looks like a nice tree, a nice setup. And Reg's parents get there, his mother and his father. There's the usual exchange of pleasantries. And, of course, Reg is as embarrassed by his parents as Patrick was by his mom, of course, because everybody's embarrassed by their parents at one point or another and cringed by them, right? A little cringy. And, Reg's mom comes in, she sweeps up Max, of course, right off the bat, her new baby, her new little precious grandchild, whom she's quick to tell Patrick is the cutest little baby in the world. Reg was the cutest baby in the world. Now he's the second cutest baby in the world, because once Max got here, Max became the cutest baby in the world. She sets about doing like a lot of grandmothers do with their grandchildren, feeding him something relatively unhealthy, but masked with a healthy name. Actually, we don't have this in game. I called it chocolate mangoes, right? Who wants some chocolate mangoes? We don't actually have chocolate mangoes in game. She's actually feeding him mangoes, but his face always looks like he's covered with chocolate when he gets done eating. So I think I'm going to just start sticking the word chocolate in front of everything he eats. So like chocolate peas, chocolate carrots, chocolate mangoes. And she feeds him some of those chocolate mangoes. And then we switch to see what she has brought for Max for Christmas, which, of course, is an obscenely huge pile of presents. And she says, you know, she knows us a lot. She knows us a lot. She knows that Max is not quite one yet. But most of these gifts, you know, he'll grow into, because that's another thing that grandparents do a lot, is they see something really cute, right? Oh, my God, that's so cute. And they buy it, even though it's like for, you know, a 2T, like a toddler, or a 3T. That's okay. Keep it. Keep it. It's not going to expire, right? I mean, clothing doesn't expire, so keep it until he gets a little bit older. That'll be fine. And then, of course, she tells Reg, you know, because they grow up. They grow up fast. Next thing you know, Max will be getting married. And speaking of marriage, hey, Patrick, why don't you tell me a little bit about yourself? That's what she has to say next, right? Because much like Patrick's mother, she anticipates, of course, that Reg and Patrick are this wonderful couple. They're so sweet and perfect for each other. Surely they're going to get married, right? Surely they've already made a date. They have not made a date. Of course, they've actually only known each other at this point, what, about 6 or 7 months. So they've not made a date, but they are a good couple, right? They're cute together. Speaking of cute, there's Reg's dad. Reg's dad will be the first to tell you. He'll be the first to tell you how great Reg is. And he starts in with, Reg is a brilliant engineer. Reg, who's also humble and modest, says, no, I'm not. You know, he thinks he's a good engineer. He would not say he's brilliant. He's not a genius, as his dad will tell you most of the time that Reg is. Reg is pretty smart, of course, but so he's a brilliant engineer. And he reiterates that with, he is smart. And in fact, he's going to build the Cascadian someday, the legendary airship of Reg's ancestors. Reg says, once again, no, Dad, I'm not. Which, you know, if you have parents, you probably get used to saying that a lot as an adult. No, I'm not. No, I'm not. No, I'm not going to do that. And then Reg's dad, of course, chimes in that naturally, Reg is quite the catch. And that Patrick is a lucky guy because, of course, Reg is handsome like his dad and kind like his dad. And a great dad like his dad. And Reg goes to say once again, no, I'm not. But this time, of course, Patrick cuts him off and says, yes, Reg, you are. Because Patrick does think that Reg is a great catch and very handsome and very kind and a great dad. Now, as you can see, Patrick was cooking dinner, and they do have a Christmas dinner. I had originally planned to make a little bit of opening presents, you know, a sort of montage of opening Christmas presents with Reg's parents. Actually, in the end, though, babies, infants do nothing with presents, and it felt like kind of completely unnecessary, right? We know what it looks like to open a present. I did have Reg and Patrick open presents from each other. Reg was happy with his. Patrick was not happy with his. I don't know what Patrick got, but he wasn't very happy with it. I can't remember what he got. Actually, I did look at the time. It was nothing. I don't know. Anyway, he wasn't happy with it. So we kind of skipped over the present part. We skipped over. That's it. To pretend and think that Max, because babies do this, babies do like presents even when they're 1 year old. You know, they see other people messing with it. They want to mess with it. So I like to pretend that Max did as well. And Reg's parents, I just decided to have them leave, of course. Let's just go ahead and have them go. We won't worry about the presents. But before they go, you know, Reg's dad tells him, hey, you know, he had been really worried about him when Julie just dropped Max off in his lap. And he'd been concerned he wouldn't be able to handle it, that he'd be overwhelmed, you know, that it really would kind of, you know, crush him, right? And instead, he's been really surprised. He's been surprised because Reg all of a sudden has made these sudden changes, right? All of a sudden made these sudden changes. He is a politician now, and he has this steady sort of relationship out of nowhere. And he's raising Max all on his own, and he seems so confident and so in charge of everything that his dad's a little kind of taken aback. And he says, you know, I think that you found you. You know, I haven't seen you look this happy and this free since your junior year in college. And he adds, you know, I listened to your campaign speeches, and because Reg's dad is a progressive, a very strong progressive, as is Reg, as is I am, by the way. He says, you know, I'm really proud of you, son. He's really proud of what Reg had to say when he was campaigning. And he's really proud of the ideas that Reg put forth during his campaign. And like anybody, like any kid, like anybody, Reg, of course, is happy. His dad is proud of him. He's happy anybody's proud of him. And he thanks his dad for it. You know, a very heartfelt thank you. Now, Reg's mom, of course, says, I know you're busy. I know you're busy right now. Every mother knows you're busy, by the way. Every mother out there knows you're busy. But guess what? They still want you to visit. They still want you to find some time to visit. And in this case, she also wants him to bring Patrick with him, of course. Her new son-in-law, her future son-in-law, as she sees it, be sure and bring Patrick with you. It goes unspoken, you're going to bring Max with you. I mean, that's unspoken. In fact, really what she's saying is, I know you're busy, but bring Max to visit. Reg says, you know, I'll try. But Patrick chimes in, no, we will. We will not try. We will be there. We will do it. And I do like to think that at this point, probably Reg has visited his parents a couple of times between June and December, of course, with Max. But maybe he has not brought Patrick with him on those visits. Patrick does have a job. He is a full-time, you know, employee someplace. And it could be the timing didn't work out. Or maybe, hey, Patrick just felt like it was too soon to go visit the parents, right? But yeah, I'm sure that Reg has visited it up until this point. With Max being, you know, a newborn and little. But Reg's mom, of course, is reiterating now, hey, don't forget Patrick next time. Now, much like the presents, there isn't a lot that infants do when it comes to the snow. In fact, I don't know that Max even realized it was cold, to be quite honest. But I did take him out there, and I had Patrick kind of do like a snow angel, right? And I had Reg kind of pretend to play with him, sort of, you know, practice standing, stuff like that. Because I did feel like that's something that the parents would do with the, you know, the first snow in San Myshuno, right? Take the baby out in the snow, show him this new snow. And while they're out there, Patrick says, kind of like, you know, what he had said at dinner, you know, a few episodes ago, he thinks Reg should build the Cascadian, right? Now, Reg thinks, you know, Patrick and his dad should go form a club and they can sit around and talk about it all day long. But Patrick is serious. Of course, Reg is just as serious as he tells him. Let's put aside for a moment the technical difficulties of lifting something the size of a recreational vehicle into the air with a balloon, right? And focus just on the fact of what it would cost. And as Reg tells him, of course, he doesn't play the lottery, but he would need to play the lottery and then win the lottery in order to afford to take on something like building this airship. Patrick's not having it, though, and he says he predicts someday you are going to build the Cascadian and you're going to take Max and I for a ride on it, and I'm holding you to it. So Reg says, okay, fine. Yeah, great. I'll do it. You know, we'll both be in the nursing home before I get it done. But yes, I'll do it. And we'll go for a ride on the Cascadian. While they're out in the snow, Patrick gets a call from a friend of his from Del Sol. His friend Derek from Del Sol contacts him and has dropped in unexpectedly, which I guess is not too out of the ordinary for Derek. And Patrick even says that as he first gets upstairs. Hey, so another unannounced visit, eh, Derek? And Derek points out, you know, he flies by the seat of his pants. And in this case, his flight actually in San Myshuno, because of the snowstorm, had been canceled. So he ended up stuck, instead of just passing through San Myshuno, changing planes, ended up stuck there for a day or two. And he had needed to talk to Patrick anyway, so he thought, hey, I'll just run by real quick and talk to him, right? Right. Now, what does he want to talk to him about? He thinks he has Patrick a job. Now, Patrick says, of course, I don't need a job. I have a job. And Derek says, not like this. Derek is an agent in Del Sol. Derek fields actors for positions on shows, but in this case, there is a new show coming, or as Derek says, of course, new in Del Sol. Obviously, it's been done before. It is a design-type show. And it's called Blow and Go. And it's basically like every other design show where, you know, Patrick would go in and blow everything up and then rebuild it and, you know, then head on out, right? And, you know, like Derek says, yeah, that's not really new, but it's a brand new name. No one's heard the name before. So it counts as a new show. And Derek wants to field Patrick for the lead of that show, for kind of the host of the show. Now, Patrick tells him, you know, I'm not an actor. Why are you here with this for me? I'm not an actor. And Derek says, he knows that, of course. He knows that Patrick's not an actor. Patrick's an interior designer. And that's what he likes, is that Patrick isn't an actor, because Derek hates working with actors. despite the fact that, of course, Derek is an agent. Derek is an agent in Del Sol. He hates working with actors, so wouldn't this be perfect? Patrick's not an actor, but also Patrick has a pretty good resume, and it's a sort of resume that sounds really impressive and really good on TV. Here is Overwatch, you know, interior designer extraordinaire with this whole list of different corporations he's worked for and projects he's done and credentials he's accumulated. Derek knows that's exactly what will sell on the Design Network shows, right? So he can tell that Patrick's a little bit in shock, because basically he says something, Patrick's like, what? And he says something, what? You know, and by the third what, you know, Derek, of course, is like, I'm going to assume you're in shock, because you know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm saying here. And if the network greenlights this project, which they really are looking at doing, then, hey, you know, this could be a great opportunity for you. Yes, not what you normally do, but it pays a ton of money. And even if he didn't stick with it, it's still yet another credential to kind of add onto his resume. And it would get his name even further out there. It would garner him a lot of recognition on the national stage. Now, the drawback, of course, is that Patrick would have to move. He would have to move from San Myshuno to Del Sol. That's where the show would be in production. And I guess basically, even if it wasn't in production all year, he would only be able to live in San Myshuno part-time at best. Of course, Derek isn't entirely aware of the changes in Patrick's life. And he says, you know, it's no problem for you. You move all the time. But looking around, suddenly hit him. Hey, what's going on here? You know, when did you start collecting stuff? When did you start buying stuff? Normally, your place looks like a hotel. Normally, it looks like someone doesn't live there. And he goes further and say, you know, is this even your place? Do you live here? Am I at someone else's apartment? Did you give me a different apartment number? Because I'm looking at, you know, babies and cats and Christmas. And he is really shocked. He's like, you know, what happened to Mr. I can't fly off into the sunset. I can't take off for the horizon if I'm chained to the ground by stuff. What happened to the free to fly guy? Now, Patrick, of course, hasn't really analyzed or thought about this a lot. Now, you know, it's just like his cat needed more stuff to play on, so he bought a bigger thing. And Max needed some place to sleep when Reg stayed over, so he bought a little bed. And Max needed some more toys. And it's Christmas, and Max loves a Christmas tree, so he bought a tree. And, you know, things just kind of accumulate when you have changes in your life, and you're adapting and accommodating those changes. And so Patrick kind of says that, right? Hey, you know, I'm still the same person. I'm still free, but I'm different. And in fact, I feel even freer than I've felt in my entire life. And there is something to that. There's something to the idea that he's free from the worry that he won't be free. You know, Patrick spent an awful lot of time trying to make sure that all of these things he was worried was going to weigh him down, all these things that were going to hold him back, he had to avoid it constantly in his life in order to be free. But that created another sort of chain and created another sort of cage and box to keep him in. And he had to spend a lot of time maintaining an empty box and making sure it stayed empty. And Derek kind of touches on that. He says, really, because, you know, I'm looking around here and all this stuff looks an awful lot like a cage. It looks an awful like the sort of thing that weighs you down. But Patrick says basically what I just said. Hey, you know, he's adaptable. He adapts. And there's a lot to be said for the freedom from worrying about being free all the time. And that because the offer would require a big change in his life, it would most likely mean moving to Del Sol. And Patrick doesn't really believe in long-distance relationships. They don't hold up well over the long term. And especially something like I imagine San Myshuno and Del Sol being literally a world apart from each other. Now, it's The Sims, so everything is just a spawn point away from each other. But in real life, of course, it would be a big change, and it would be something he'd really have to consider. Could he leave Reg and Max behind in San Myshuno for this opportunity in Del Sol, which does kind of appeal to him, this idea that, hey, maybe he could be on TV, maybe he could be famous, and it is a lot of money, right? It's a lot of money. But even though it is a unique opportunity, he has another unique opportunity right there in Myshuno. He has finally found a lot of the things that have finally, truly, really made him free. So that's what we'll look at next time. Next time on the RM Cascadian Growing Together, where will Patrick go from here? And where will Reg and Max go in his regard? And where are all three of them going together? They're going on vacation coming up on the RM Cascadian Growing Together. Next time, they're going to Batu, the Batu theme park, to stay on board the Celestial Pyroclastium, the First Order cruise ship in orbit above Batu. They're going to go on vacation and give Patrick a chance to think about the future and maybe talk to Reg about the future as well. And it's Valentine's Day. That's why they're on vacation. And it's Max's birthday. Max is about to turn 1 year old on the Celestial Pyroclastium. Pyroclastium, how would you say that? I was thinking of like a pyroclastic flow, but coming from outer space to cover, you know, a planet. It sounds like something the First Order would name a ship, right? Celestial, being up in space. Pyroclastium, being like a pyroclastic flow from a volcano that literally destroys everything in its path. But it's a cruise ship, too, so there's a lot of fun to be had up there with the First Order. Join me next time. Please hit like, subscribe, and notify, and join me next time for that episode. And the rest of the adventure of the RM Cascadian Growing Together series, which is coming to an end. There are only 3 more episodes of this particular series before we move on to the next series of the RM Cascadian. Growing Together is coming to an end. Three more episodes, Valentine's Day, Easter, and Memorial Day. So please join me next time. And in the meantime, as always, thanks for watching.